Every first-time filmmaker will say, like, if you didn't film it, you don't get to edit with it later. If it's not in the can, it's not in the movie. And that's a hard lesson to learn, because sometimes you'll have a really strong opinion on how you want to shoot something on the day, and you go, no, this is what it's gonna be. I know my brain, I'm shooting it like this, and then you get into the edit and go, like, wish I'd just shot it another way. Three. Hi. I'm Lin-Manuel Miranda. Today we're going to talk about the creative process in directing my first feature, Tick, Tick, Boom. This is First Film. Film is my first love. I have wanted to be a director since I was 3 years old. I spent my summers in Puerto Rico knocking around my grandfather's video store. He owned a VHS video store called Miranda Video. I watched all kinds of age-inappropriate entertainment as an unsupervised youth and always loved movies. Then I kind of fell in love with theater along the way, and I went to college intending to study both. I sort of majored in theater instead of film out of practicality. You have to pay for your own senior film. When you're a theater major, the school gives you the 200 bucks for the lights and the costumes. It was a very simple transaction of you write it, you put it up on stage. You write it, you put it up on stage. It's harder with film. I think that for your first film, I think it's important to go personal because you're going to have to make more decisions than you're prepared to make at any given time. And so if it's coming from an authentic place, you'll know the answers. Even if you don't know why they're the answers, you'll know the answers because you know the world and you know the story you're trying to tell.
You guys, where you were at the start? Where they were at the top?
You're gonna get questions about the color of the tablecloth and the light, and if you know all the answers because it's from somewhere deep within you, I don't mean necessarily literally, you know, I never worked at a diner, but I knew the answers because I'd watched that footage of Jonathan on his last day at the diner, and I know what it's like to work to do what you have to do so you can do what you want to do. That part of it is authentic, and I've been that struggling songwriter, and so those answers will be clearer if you are very clear on what you need. I saw the off-Broadway production of Tick, Tick, Boom, and I go see this musical by the guy who got me started writing musicals because Rent changed my life, and it was somehow even more concentrated and personal an attack than Rent was. Hey, Lin, here's a sneak preview of your 20s. That pretty girl sitting next to you with the amazing voice, she's gonna get a real job. You guys aren't gonna be together anymore. All your friends, they're gonna get real jobs. It's just gonna be you banging your head against the wall of your childhood dream, and the world is gonna tell you no every day of your life.
I have rejection letters from every major and minor producer, theater company, record label, and film studio in existence, and in just over a week, I will be 30 years old.
Let's go ahead to scenes 47 to 52 and get the dress.
So I prepared the show as if I were workshopping an original musical. I think we did 3 or 4 readings where I would just get a bunch of actors around Andrew Garfield and we would read through the material. We'd take a week to learn all the songs.
I've taken out some bass drums, so don't be alarmed.
Oh my God, thank you for warning me.
And then Steven and I would go back and retool, and then we would do another reading, like a year and a half of just readings before cameras were anywhere near the place. Andrew's taking piano lessons, he's taking voice lessons. So at each one of those, he sings a little more. I think the first one, he only sang Boho Days, because it was a cappella. There's no way to be off key, you're just singing. And he sang on Sunday, because it was a group number and he felt comfortable singing in a large group, but he was really scared. And rightfully so, he'd never done this on this scale. By the last workshop, Andrew is blowing the doors off the place with his voice. But that evolution was really gradual and amazing to witness. I mean, my biggest thing in directing actors was sort of do unto others as you would have them do unto you. I tried to treat them like grown-ups, and I cast them because they were the best people for these roles. I tried to develop a private language with each of them and let them know what they needed. Some actors are more technical. They just want to hear, like, we're closer in on you, and, like, literally dial knobs in terms of what you're already doing, sort of giving them the guardrails of how to modulate their performance. And some are really instinctual. I remember going to one actor during like kind of an argument scene being like, "You're right." Like, you have to remember that you are right. That person is yelling in your face, but you are actually right, and you're allowed to say you're right, and it worked wonders. I think the biggest challenge with adapting musicals to the screen is the suspension of disbelief is tougher. It's just tougher. When you walk into a theater and there's a big proscenium around everything that's happening, you're like, they better break into song. I didn't pay for a play. It's easier to just sort of figure out that transition between speech and song. When a camera is right here and it looks like real life, and it looks like the life you and I live in, the threshold is higher to establish a world in which people can break into song and express themselves that way. It's always amazing to see how different filmmakers approach it, whether it's On the Town and that one sailor who starts to walk it in and goes, "I feel like I'm not out of bed yet." And you're like, boom, I'm with him, like, let's go. For this, I immediately thought, well, this was a rock monologue first. Jonathan with a rock band, and as soon as his hands touch the piano, we can go anywhere we want. There's a truism in musical theater that the opening number establishes the world of your musical, and it establishes music's relationship to the audience and how the characters feel about each other, all of it. With Hamilton, I really pushed that. The opening number, everyone is just a person, they're all wearing the same color clothes, and it's a very Sweeney Todd-ish intro. Attend this tale, it's important, and then at the end, they start putting on their characters. It's very Brechtian. Then in Helpless Satisfied, we say, oh, we reserve the right to stop time, freeze it, and rewind it if we need to. I also believed in that in this, like opening, we're establishing that we're gonna go into the world in Jonathan's mind, that these musical numbers are the world according to Jonathan Larson, and then using every number to push on that. The opening number of In the Heights is nothing if not a guide to how to experience this neighborhood. We learned a lot from Fiddler on the Roof, which is like the greatest opening number ever written. It's like, here's what the show is about, tradition.
Tradition!
Here is our village. I'm going to introduce you to them in concentric circles expanding outward. I am Tevya. I have five daughters. Here are the other special folks in our village. And we learned a lot from that with Heights in terms of like, here's our main storyteller, Usnavi. Here's the people most important to him, Abuela, Sonny, then expand out local businesses. Here's Kevin from next door. Here's the ladies from the salon next door. Expand out. Here's his best friend, Benny. Here's Vanessa. And here's the neighborhood. Let's go. And so letting people in and letting an opening number be an onion. It looks like this, but we're gonna open it up and reveal all the layers. You know, and the opening number 3090 does that, right? Like very simply, like he's playing piano, he's playing with a rock band. We cut to a scene in the diner. It seems like a semi-realistic scene. Next time we see those characters, they are singing and dancing in his apartment. So it's like just each time, just like inching the audience along, like we reserve the right to do this. We see him and Susan in the Strand. Super realistic dialogue. You quit your job? What?
You just quit?
Well, no, I just quit. I gave my notice.
And now everyone in the Strand can sing. So like just bringing out the fact that in Jonathan's world, this can happen. We went to the Library of Congress with Jen Tepper, who's a Jonathan Larson historian, and we just grabbed everything and we threw it all in the pile. The songs he performed in the monologue, songs from Superbia, his unproduced musical, songs from the off-Broadway version, and said, what's our movie? And we threw everything up on this board. Now we're creating an original musical with Jonathan Larson's songs. And I think we cut three songs from the off-Broadway version. We put back in two from his rock monologue, along with two no one had heard from Superbia. That gets into the skill set I know how to do, which is craft an evening. What do the songs in this order do to your heart? And then how does the storytelling sort of lead us into those things? I think that's also one of the most important things about our movie. This is not one of those biopics where you see the Mozart writing his masterpiece. This is a movie about failure and getting back up. And his masterpiece is ahead of him. And it's hopeful because maybe so is yours. We did storyboards for the more elaborate numbers, chief among them Sunday. I learned to take big swings from John M. Chu. He envisioned such an epic scope for this little movie about Washington Heights. I always pictured it as this tiny little indie movie. And he was like, no, Lin, your characters have big dreams. You're allowed to take up space and have big dreams. And if anything in this is a love letter to John M. Chu, it's the Sunday sequence in our movie. And I don't think I would have had the courage to swing as big as I did on that sequence without John as a guide and a friend. A lot of this begins with the conception of the number, and then we figure out sort of the best way to stage it and pre-visualize it. With Sunday, it's an homage to Sunday in the Park with George. That is a big choral number in Sunday in the Park with George. John only ever sang it as a one-man band. And so I, as the filmmaker, have an opportunity to give Jonathan Larson the chorus he never heard on this song. And so I want to build Jonathan Larson's dream chorus. So I want to put in the people that were special to the shows he loved. But I also want to give him this kind of galaxy brain moment that exists outside of time. I knew I wanted to turn the Moondance Diner into a proscenium. And then as we were brainstorming, I also thought, we can also turn the moon dance into a marquee, and we could do music and lyrics by Jonathan Larson, which is something he never saw in his lifetime. Collaboration's so important, and it's so important to listen to the very smart people you hired and let the best idea in the room win. I can tell you so many shots I would never have thought of on my own that are in this movie because I had this incredible underwater photographer in the pool, and I shot the things that were on my mind, and then I said, what cool things don't I know you can do? And he went, oh, great. And then we really had some fun because he does this on every movie, and this is just my only movie. And again, I have three incredible underwater shots in that movie that would never have occurred to me because I asked the expert, how far can you push me, and what crazy thing can you show me that I haven't seen before? I want the vibe of, this is so fun, can you believe we get to do this? That's the vibe I want on set. We are in the school play, and we are not doing this for money. We're not doing this for extra credit. We're doing this because we love it. And pressure is gonna be there regardless, but we can have fun and remember why we're doing it while we're here. This was a little of my experience directing Tick, Tick, Boom, and you can check out my first film on Netflix right now.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the Netflix Film Club channel to get our latest exclusive videos. Plus, hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.